In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel had a dream and visions of his head upon his bed. Then he wrote the dream and told the sum of the matters. Daniel spake and said, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of the heaven strove upon the great sea, and four great beasts came up from the sea, diverse one from another. The first was like a lion and had eagle's wings. I beheld till the wings thereof were plucked, and it was lifted up from the earth, and may stand upon the feet as a man, and a man's heart was given to it. And behold, another beast, the second like to a bear, and it raised up itself on one side, and had three ribs in the mouth of it, between the teeth of it. And they said thus unto it, Arise, devour much flesh. After this I beheld, and lo, another, like a leopard, which had upon the back of it four wings of a fowl. The beast had also four heads, and dominion was given to it. After this I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible, and strong exceedingly, and it had great iron teeth that devoured and broke in pieces, and stamped the residue with the feet of it, and it was diverse from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. And I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another little horn, before whom there were three of the first horns plucked up by the roots. And behold, in this horn were eyes like the eyes of man, and a mouth speaking great things. And I beheld till the thrones were cast down, and the Ancient of Days did sit, whose garment was white as snow, and the hair of his head was like the pure wool, his throne was like the fiery flame, and his wheels as burning fire. So there you have it, a vision of kingdoms, and finally get to a little horn, and after that little horn comes on the scene, he says the Ancient of Days, referring to God himself, who has a throne, and fiery flames came out, and he says his throne was like a fiery flame. And he sat on his throne, and every other throne was cast down. He said, I beheld till the thrones were cast down, and the Ancient of Days did sit. So you're looking at all these kingdoms culminating in one little horn coming on the scene, and then the Ancient of Days, God, the Eternal One, coming to cast down all kingdoms and to establish a millennial rule. So tonight we're talking about a part two of a message we started earlier in the year, last year. We're going to complete it now this year. We're talking about Daniel's Little Horn, Part 2. Daniel's Little Horn, Part 2. Looking at that little horn there, who is the Antichrist. He that opposes Christ comes as a man filled with the power of Satan to oppose Jesus Christ and his dominion and his throne. The Antichrist, Daniel's Little Horn, speaks great swelling words and all kinds of high sounding, high volume things he's saying to control and rule the earth. And people not knowing who he is or what he is will follow him looking for an answer to all the tribulation and trouble in their lives. Daniel's little horn. Now look over at Daniel 12, verse 8. Says, now heard, but I understood not. Then said I, O my Lord, what shall be the end of these things? This is Daniel talking to God. And he said, go thy way, Daniel, for the words are closed up and sealed to the time of the end. Many shall be purified and made white and tried, but the wicked shall do wickedly, and none of the wicked shall understand, but the wise shall understand. Now remember, none of the wicked shall understand. If you're evil, you cannot understand this. You won't even begin to fathom what's going on because the wicked are sealed off from the revelation of truth, honesty, integrity, and morality. The wicked will not understand, but the wise shall understand. And from the time that the daily sacrifice shall be taken away and the abomination that maketh desolate set up, there shall be 1,290 days, exactly 3.5 years. In the Jewish calendar, a year is 360 days. 360 days. Per year, 3 years and a half of a year gives you 1,290 days. Blessed is he that waits and comes to the 1,335 days, but go thy way till the end be, for thou shalt rest and stand in thy lot at the end of days. All right. So he says that the abomination that maketh desolate shall be set up. Basically, we know now that that's an image set up in the Jewish tabernacle that the Antichrist will require the Jewish people to worship. So it's when you get that abomination set up that make of the whole nation desolate, then the clock is about to start running. So you won't see, that's the first 3.5 year period going by. But in the middle of the seventh week, in the middle of that 7 year period, the abomination of desolation is set up. The Antichrist is revealed as an anti-God, says, now I'm God, now worship the image I've set up. Now you have the last 3.5 year period that's going to be the consummation of the ages, the Bible calls it, when all things will come to an end. And Daniel's trying to find out when this is going to happen. He says, look, seal up the book. Go and stand in your lot till the end be, for thou shalt rest and stand in thy lot in the end of the days. You'll be around when it ends, but right now I'm telling you a limited amount of information. Don't worry about the end. Just go ahead and be prepared for your lot when it comes. So you got the little horn establishing a kingdom, setting up an image in a temple, and then requiring all the Jewish people to worship that image. Remember, the last 7 years of the tribulation period is now God changing away from the Gentile nations. He switches all forces back over to Israel and the Jews now, and it's time to deal with the Jews to get them to see Jesus as the Messiah, those that will, and then graft them back in to the tree so everything will be consumed and fulfilled in Jesus. So he's going to shift his focus away from the Gentiles back over to the Jews, who are the original fruit or the original seed that he first established. And once he makes that shift back to the Jews, the clock is going to begin to run for all the world to end. That last 7 year period. That 7 year period will now see the culmination of the age. The millennial rule will begin with the 1,000 year rule of Jesus Christ will be down here. 1,000 year rule, he says, is going to rule with a rod of iron. Meaning he's going to rule by force. Then after that 1,000 year rule, the Bible says Satan will be released again for a season. And you're going to see Satan destroyed and cast into the lake of fire where the false prophet and the beast already are. That's how this whole thing is going to culminate. But if we don't know that, we'll go happy-go-lucky day by day doing everything we always do, thinking there'll be nothing going wrong. But believe me, the clock is running. Just like the little baby Robin and Antonio had. When that baby came out of the womb and that doctor slapped that baby on the behind, that baby was dying. When that seed hit that sperm in the mother's womb, the baby was dying. You don't grow up to life, you grow up to death. Somebody told me before church, you got something on your mustache. I said, oh, that's gray hair. See, I'm getting old, I'm dying. Everybody is. You're growing to death because this is a temporary house, and this is a temporary house. This is not eternal. And we got multitudes of people putting all their focus in on this present life and this present world. When you're in a time machine that's dying every day by degrees. I'm telling you, as soon as there's a contact made, sperm and egg, and that life originates and it begins to germinate, that baby's dying right there. But we see a newborn baby, new life, his whole future's in front of it. That baby's dying. The clock is on that baby. From the minute that baby's formed in the womb, the clock is on that baby. In a time and space continuum, in a time and space suit, that's going to grow old, wither, and die. Just like a rose. A rose has a life cycle. It looks good and beautiful. You look at that rose and you smell it and it's so refreshing. You set that rose in your room for 6 months and come back and look at it. It's going to be withered, dried up, petals falling off, dead. Why? Because it's a life cycle. What we have to do in our life cycle is get our relationship right with God so when we leave here, we can enter into an eternal life cycle. That's free from the filth and degradation of this world. But people loving this world don't see the impending doom that's coming, and they're set down here for their own destruction. Daniel's little horn, how he operates, how to get people to follow him, what has to be in a person to follow this thing. That's what we're discussing tonight. Father, we thank you for this time. We ask you to bless our minds to understand your word, open our minds to be able to comprehend what you're saying, that we might see the truth of the Bible and make it correspond to us in this present generation. We need the bondage of the world, the fears of the world, the spirits of the world, castigated from us and denied access to our minds, that we might grow in grace and in the image of your Son, Jesus Christ, creating us a right heart, a clean heart, and purify all of our motivations and our intents, that we might be able to see clearly and understand these last days and what we're called to do in them. We give you the praise, the glory, and honor for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey, look over at 2 Kings chapter 23. 2 Kings chapter 23, go back there. And we begin to see the real problem in people. The Antichrist is coming to power very rapidly. What's going to make people follow him after all this knowledge about the Antichrist and the devil, etc., etc.? Even people who are just playing around with God know about the Antichrist. They're going to follow him right on anyway. How will it happen? Why will it happen? We're looking at 2 Kings chapter 23, verse 1. Talking about King Josiah. It says, and the king sent, and they gathered unto him all the elders of Judah and of Jerusalem. And the king went up into the house of the Lord, and all the men of Judah and all the inhabitants of Jerusalem with him, and the priests and the prophets and all the people, both small and great. And he read in their ears all the words of the book of the covenant, which was found in the house of the Lord. And the king stood by a pillar and made a covenant before the Lord to walk after the Lord and to keep his commandments and his testimonies and his statutes with all their heart and all their soul, to perform the words of this covenant that were written in this book. And all the people stood to the covenant. Remember, you obey with all your heart and all of your soul. And the king commanded Hilkiah, the high priest, and the priests of the second order, and the keepers of the door, to bring forth out of the temple of the Lord all the vessels that were made for Baal, and for the grove, and for all the host of heaven. And he burned them without Jerusalem in the fields of Kidron, and carried the ashes of them into Bethel. And he put down the idolatrous priests whom the kings of Judah had ordained to burn incense in the high places in the cities of Judah, and in the places round about Jerusalem, them also that burn incense unto Baal, to the sun, and to the moon, and to the planets, and to all the host of heaven. And we're looking at idolatry, worship of false gods. And he brought out the grove from the house of the Lord without Jerusalem unto the brook Kidron, and burned it at the brook Kidron, and stamped it small to powder, and cast the powder thereof unto the graves of the children of the people. And he broke down the houses of the Sodomites that were by the house of the Lord, for the women wove hangings for the grove. Now remember, the house of the Sodomites, which were right by the temple of God, homosexuals, catamites, lesbians, every freaking sexual perversion you can name, right there in the middle of the camp. He was destroying everything that was filthy and defiling the element they lived in. He had to destroy everything that was foreign and idolatrous. And he brought out all the priests out of the cities of Judah and defiled the high places where the priests had burned incense, from Geba to Beersheba, and broke down the high places of the gates that were in the inner end of the gate of Joshua, the governor of the city, which were on a man's left hand at the gate of the city. Nevertheless, the priests of the high places came not up to the altar of the Lord in Jerusalem, but they did eat of the unleavened bread among their brethren. And he defiled Topheth, which is in the valley of the children of Hinnom, that no man might make his son or his daughter pass through the fire to Molech. What they did with that, now they put the children on the altar and sacrificed them up to Molech. Molech had hands extended in front of them. They started firing those stone hands, and the hands would get hot until they glowed like red embers. They heat up those hands, and then they take the babies and set the babies on the hot hands. And the baby would basically just disintegrate. Just like they do in abortions nowadays. Vacuum extraction. Then they got the other saline solution abortion that burns the baby alive in the womb. Now they got the partial birth abortion where they pull the baby halfway out of the womb, put a suction device in the skull, and suck the brain out. So you can't butcher 40 million babies like this. The same thing that happened to Israel is happening now. Selfishness is sacrificing up children. They're inconvenient. I don't want one. I didn't mean to get pregnant. So just kill the child at the child's expense. But don't make me be burned down with a child. See, this thing is going to cause the most dramatic curse to come on this country we could ever imagine. See why the elements and all the atmosphere is in turmoil. Every time you see a weather happening, it's always extreme. It's because God is getting mad. And when he starts getting mad, God can do things that other people can't do to. Only God can make all of this right here start shaking and all of it start come crashing down. Might destroy a bunch of people all in one good gathering. See, God can do a lot of things to folks. You cannot keep just thumbing your nose at God thinking nothing's going to happen, because something is going to happen. You reap what you sow. And he took away the horses that the kings of Judah had given to the son at the inner end of the house of the Lord by the chamber of Nathan-Melech, the chamberlain, which was in the suburbs, and burned the chariots of the sun with fire. And the altars that were on top of the upper chamber of Ahaz, which the kings of Judah had made, and the altars which Manasseh had made in the two courts of the house of the Lord, did the king beat down and broke them down from thence and cast the dust of them into the brook Kidron. And the high places that were before Jerusalem, which were on the right hand of the Mount of Corruption, which Solomon, the king of Israel, had builded for Ashtaroth, the abomination of the Zidonians, and for Chemosh, the abomination of the Moabites, and for Milcom, the abomination of the children of Ammon, did the king defile. Now you know what Solomon did. He had all these old foreign wives. He built all these idols so his wives could worship their gods and defile the camp of Israel with these foreign idols. And he broke in pieces the images and cut down the groves and filled their places with the bones of men. Moreover, the altar that was at Bethel and the high place was Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, who made Israel descend it made. Both that altar and the high place he broke down and burned the high place and stamped it small to powder and burned the grove. And as Josiah turned himself, he spied the sepulchers that were there in the mount and sent and took the bones out of the sepulchers and burned them upon the altar and polluted it, according to the word of the Lord, which the man of God proclaimed, who proclaimed these words. Then he said, "What title is that I see?" And the men of the city told him, "It is the sepulcher of the man of God, which came from Judah, and proclaimed these things that thou hast done against the altar of Bethel." And he said, "Let him alone, let no man move his bones." So they let his bones alone with the bones of the prophet that came out of Samaria. And all the houses also of the high places that were in the cities of Samaria, which the kings of Israel had made to provoke the Lord to anger, Josiah took away and did to them according to all the acts that had been done in Bethel. And he slew all the priests of the high places that were there upon the altars, and burned men's bones upon them, and returned to Jerusalem. And the king commanded all the people, saying, "Keep the Passover unto the Lord your God, as it is written in the book of his covenant." Surely there was not holding such a Passover from the days of the judges that judged Israel, nor in all the days of the kings of Israel, nor the kings of Judah. But in the 18th year of King Josiah, wherein this Passover was holden to the Lord in Jerusalem. Moreover, the workers with familiar spirits and the wizards and the images and the idols and all the abominations that were spied in the land of Judah and in Jerusalem, did Josiah put away, that he might perform the words of the law which were written in the book that Hilkiah the priest found in the house of the Lord. And like unto him was there no king before him that turned to the Lord with all his heart and with all of his soul, and with all his might, according to all the law of Moses, neither after him arose there any like him. Notwithstanding, the Lord turned not from the fierceness of his great wrath, wherewith his anger was kindled against Judah, because of all the provocations that Manasseh provoked him withal. And the Lord said, I will remove Judah also out of my sight, as I have removed Israel, and will cast off his city, this city, Jerusalem, which I have chosen, and the house of which I said, my name shall be there. And then later on, Josiah died and other rulers came. And they kept going through these cycles of one king destroying the high places and the idols, and another king comes and sets them back up again. But anyway, there was no king like Josiah. Turned to the Lord with all of his heart, all of his soul, all of his might. Jesus said it. Worship the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, your soul, and your strength. This thing has to be a total man worship. There can be nothing left out. No area left unclean. Every idol must go. All right. Look over to Isaiah chapter 28. Idolatry is the problem, the filthy problem that's causing God's wrath to be poured out. Isaiah 28, verse 14. Says, "Wherefore hear the word of the Lord, you scornful men that rule this people which is in Jerusalem. Because you have said, we have made a covenant with death, and with hell are we at agreement. When the overflowing scourge shall pass through, it shall not come unto us. For we have made lies our refuge, and under falsehood have we hid ourselves." Look at that. We made lies our home, and we've hid ourselves and covered ourselves with falsehoods. That's the idolatry right there. I'm making a lie where I live. And I'm hiding myself under a bunch of false myths. And I'm thinking, when God's wrath comes, I'll be hidden under these lies. Therefore, thus saith the Lord God, behold, I lay in Zion for a foundation, a stone, a tried stone, a precious cornerstone, a sure foundation. He that believeth shall not make haste. Judgment also will I lay to the line, and righteousness to the plummet. And the hail shall sweep away the refuge of lies, and the water shall overflow the hiding place. And your covenant with death shall be disannulled, and your agreement with hell shall not stand. When the overflowing scourge shall pass through you, then you shall be trodden down by it. So what is he saying? Okay, you think that this lie and this falsehood is going to stand. When I make my move, I'm going to destroy the lie and you, the falsehood and you, and you're going to be overflowed with my wrath. Because you refuse to yield to what? The truth. You know the truth makes you free. Says, I send the truth, you deny the truth, a strong delusion comes, you hide up under a lie and act as if it's the truth. I talked to a guy the other day, been telling him about the law for a year. You know what he came and pulled out of his pocket? A New World's Translation of the Bible. See, I'm standing with the Jehovah. Said, man, you're sealing your own doom. You couldn't receive the truth, but you can drink down this lie with no resistance. Why? Because I don't want to change what I am inside. I'm going to find a lie to confirm what I am and keep me like I am because I don't want to change. That's the most damnable thing you'll ever do in your life. People come right here, and because they don't want to change, they back out of here. If I'm lying, you're safe. But if I'm telling the truth, they are sealing their own damnation. They're going to go to hell. You can't back away from the truth and be the same. If the truth comes and you back away from it, from that day forth, you will get progressively worse. That's the way it is. Until you yield to the truth, there will be no staying stagnant. You get worse or better. I tell people the gospel is a constant. What the gospel does, it stays like it is. It draws you to the gospel and transforms you, or it drives you away from the gospel so you can be conformed to the world. But you will be changed. You'll either get worse or better based on your response to the gospel. The most dangerous thing you can ever be interacting with is the truth. Because if you deny the truth, you will get progressively worse. And you'll see people basically go insane right before your very eyes if their minds are clouded up with lies, fantasies, and make-believe, and their souls filled with idols. Now, why do they go crazy? I'm going to show you why people go crazy when they deny the truth tonight. It's simple to understand it. Remember, we're talking about Daniel's little horn now. How can Daniel's little horn, the Antichrist, rule over people and the people just accept it? You have to understand, we're a temple. You worship gods in a temple. The Antichrist rules over people full of lies and fantasies. That's the key. If truth is in you, he can't rule you. He's a false god, remember, he's not a real god. If I'm a lie myself, I have to rule over those that are full of lies. See, if you don't have an appetite for the truth, you're not saved. The appetite for truth comes with the salvation. You can't accept the truth about you, your circumstances, about God, his kingdom. You need to get saved. You see people all flittering around and double-minded and trying to find flaws with stuff and not wanting to accept things and argumentative and always debating about something. And they need to get saved, that's all. Because when you're saved, the truth will be digestible. You'll crave it. You'll long for it. You'll study your Bible looking for it. You want the truth. As a matter of fact, once you're exposed to truth, you can't even take lies anymore. You don't even want to hear it. Preacher, come on with some more mess. I'm so sick of this mess. Just turn it off. Why? Because no appetite for a lie anymore. No appetite for make-believe. No appetite for hypocrisy. No appetite for some fool trying to control you. So trying to preach laws over you. Trying to dominate you, manipulate you. You just can't take it anymore. All I want is the truth to be liberated. My sole endeavor in life is to be free. And the truth will make you free. So if you find bondage slipping in on you, what's that telling you? Somewhere there's a lie up in here. Because a lie will bind you. Truth will liberate you. Bible says, well, the Spirit of the Lord is their liberty. Then you know the Spirit of the Lord is the Spirit of truth. We got to have the truth. Here's the problem, though. Remember he said he served him with all of his heart, all of his soul, all of his might. The problem is found in the human soul. That's why I preach about the soul so much, because that's where the problem is. Bible says the soul that sinneth, it shall die. It's a soul salvation. Your spirit, when you come to Jesus and confess Jesus, your spirit man is immediately regenerated and brought back alive. It's alive now. Now, God comes into your spirit because he birthed it again by the uncorruptible seed. He said you're born again by uncorruptible, incorruptible seed. He reinstates his life in you and you come back alive again. But what happened is you'll find yourself at the point of salvation, you're going what I call a quick high. You'll jump up and feel like the world is beautiful. I have no problem. It's great. You'll stay like that for a minute. You'll stay like that for a while and everything looks great. The grass looks greener. The birds sing louder. All of that. But after that, now God has to chasten you and complete the work in you. So you find yourself downshifting back down into a level where he can deal with you, and immediately you begin to become conscious of what's in your soul that's still defiling you. Because he begins to interact you with that word, and the word begins to reveal your soul to you to show you just how much stuff is still in you that's not right. Now, you take a pure white rag, soak the rag in mud, ketchup, mustard, slop, hot sauce, Tabasco sauce, Worcestershire sauce, put all that on that cloth, dig it in, grind it in, and go in home and throw it in the washing machine, wash it, put it in the dryer, dry it, and pull it up and look at it. What are you going to mostly see? Stains. You washed it, but it's stained. That's the human soul. The human soul is stainable. It's able to carry images. The images are the idols. This is why you can be saved and still have your soul carrying images, impulses, desires, feelings, etc. that are anti-God. Now, we have to deal with the human soul. I think the human soul is basically containerized. What do I mean by that? It's like the image is a small little container, like a little can. Images. That's the container. But that container, that image has no power unless it's powered up through life. And here's where the problem is, see. As the Israelites, see, now why would God care about them going to bow down before a stone image, or a tree? Who cares about that? What's the big deal with this? But you read it over in the New Testament, he says what? They that eat and drink and offer up their food to idols, they're not communing with idols, they're communing with devils. That's the problem. Whenever you see God just destroy a whole massive group or something, the people and the surroundings weren't the problem, the demons were the problem. That's why he said, look, destroy that whole tribe, burn the whole tribe up. They're demon infested. If you interact with those people and join yourself to those people, the demons in them are going to transfer to you. Destroy them. You wonder why God was going to force Mars and destroy all these different tribes? They were demon infested. He was keeping a pure, separate, sanctified people separated from the demon infested people. What happened to us in the world? We went out there ignorant to sin, ignorant to the realm of God, ignorant to the spiritual world, ignorant to the wiles of the devil, just blind, dumb, fat, happy. Happy-go-lucky out in the world doing everything we were big enough to do. And guess what happened? We became demon infested. What does the devil do? He compartmentalizes your soul with little containers. It's just like the statue the Israelites built. When they came with the food, they put the food down in front of the idol. They prayed over the food and invited the spirit living in the idol to enter into the food. When you eat the food, you're partaking of the nature of the demon. Same way we do it with Holy Communion. We say we're communing with Christ, partaking of his nature, through drinking his blood, eating the bread, which is symbolic of his flesh. We're communing with Jesus. Same thing they do with the idols. Now, let's say, for instance, you spend a lot of time out in the world in pornography. Guess what's happening? Your imagination is operating. See, if you look at pornography, if you look at soap operas, if you read porno books, Playboy, Penthouse, that kind of stuff, nobody reads or interacts with those images without projecting themselves into the image. See, you can't get excited about pornography unless you displace the actor with yourself. So that girl's not doing it with that guy. That girl's doing that to me. So you get aroused in response to looking at that thing, and your mind is displacing that person with you, and now you're over there in the scene. Guess what's going to happen to your soul? Your soul is going to pick up that you lived through that experience and going to imprint with it. You go out there and you fool around and cut the fool with different sexual partners. You imprint with images from every sexual partner because you're picking up what's in their soul, and it's just painting across you. I like to call it a movie camera. It's like movie film because your soul is alive. It's thriving. When you begin to run a movie camera, it's recording the images on the film. And that's what's happening to us through the eye gate, the ear gate, etc. These sensory perceptors are printing out on our soul. But guess what's happening? It's printing the images, but the image won't hurt you. What has to happen to make that image hurt you? The demon has to come into the image to make it alive. Look at it like this. Let's say, for instance, you drive by my house. No lights on, no TV playing, no radio on, no cars in the driveway, all the lights shut down, the house is just sealed up, closed up. What are you going to say to yourself? He's not at home. He's not at home. Why? There's no life in the house. So how do you know that a demon is inside of you? From the thoughts, from the impulses, from the feelings, from the desires. That's telling you it's another life there. Why are you thinking this? Why are you feeling this? Why are you desiring this? It's something in the house. But guess what? A demon can't stay in you if there's no image for the demon to inhabit. See, the images have to be eradicated. Remove the image, and the demon must go. That's why I said repent. Turn around. But what are we doing? We're seeing Christians dabble in the world, come to church. Dabble in the world, come to church. Guess what? That image never eradicates itself, it never moves. Because we keep on painting over the same old image. Still looking at the soap opera, still doing the same old food, still in the same old places, having the same old stuff. The image just stays there, and the demon stays there. That's what sanctification and holiness is. I separate myself away from the thing that can paint that image, and now I expose myself to the Word of God. It's doing what? Painting another image. All spirits must live in an image. The Holy Ghost must live in an image. I show it in the Bible verbatim. Well, we're missing it by 1,000 miles. I'll tell you something even more dangerous than actually partaking in sin a lot of times. You know what it is? The ability of a human mind to fantasize. Because the soul gonna pick up as you living through the experience. See, a mind is dangerous because a mind can both see and hear. And you can sit right here and have your mind way over there somewhere. And your imagination can go on all kind of trips. Your imagination can go out of space. You can imagine yourself on Mars. You can imagine yourself in Europe walking through the streets of London. You can imagine yourself anywhere you want to. And so some people's imagination becomes so real that they think it's real. I minister people who've been at home crying the day a guy got married because they thought that guy was my husband. They'd imagine it so strong till I just know he's mine. Then the guy married a girl over here and they happy as they can be. And you sitting home thinking, he gonna come to himself, realize the mistake he's made. And God's still telling me he's mine. And now you are playing soulless prayer for them to realize they made a mistake. And they break up so you can get them. Because your imagination still won't let it go. It's a chamber there reinforced by a spirit. Why does it say forgive if you have aught against any? Because there's a chamber there that a spirit lives in. You need to forgive to get that chamber eradicated so the spirit can leave. Judge not lest you be judged. You set up a chamber in you. If the chamber's set up, the spirit can live there. Your imagination can destroy you. And you know one of the biggest and quickest ways to create imaginary images in a person? I'm dead serious, too. This right here is a deadly way to do it. And the devil is the most skilled individual on earth at this particular avenue of intrusion. It's the music. That music can paint an image in you so strong until you'll be living that thing out, knowing it's real. All the old lust songs and the seductive songs and the smooth songs. Why do you think he has the rappers saying this filth? These rappers singing this filth for these young people. He's creating chambers in them. You got young girls now who have not been to church. See, we got a generation of people who their mothers didn't go to church. You see what I'm saying? Now the kid never went. They have, see us, you went to a little Sunday school class here and there. You heard a little bit about God. You know, you had a little bit of God, something your grandmama told you, something to hang on to, right? So that kind of balanced out what you do a little bit. Enough God just not to go crazy. And no go, I can't take it that far, because God is up. He might kill me. At least it was that much fear. You know what I'm saying? God would be mad. God might strike me down with lightning. Oh, that's all wrong, but still it was enough to keep you from doing the extreme. But you get a wicked and untaught generation who has no consciousness of God, they'll lay right down the street and have sex and won't feel a thing about it. You don't believe that? That's the freaknik. Why'd they do it? They got no consciousness. The Bible said consciousness will be seared with a hot iron. Not conscious of wrong. Not conscious of God. I'm my own person. I do what I want to do. Now that can be very dangerous, but it also can be very useful. You know why? Because when you come with the pure, unadulterated truth, you have no resistance from religion either. You can pump heat, and they can take it. Because they're sinning hard. When you sin hard, you can take the gospel straight. See, I drink my whiskey straight. And when the gospel comes, you can take it straight. A lot of old tenderoni folks that came from the old religious environment, they already got some junk ingrained in them, so they hear the truth. And that old program they got from religion kicks in, and they can't even hear it. What's causing all the schisms, the denominations, all the animosity in churches where people can't fellowship together? The people have images set up in them, and spirits fill the images. What images? The image of the preacher. It's the preacher's personality. He preached his personality down to the people. Demons feel the image, and now they act just like the preacher. They say what he says, they go where he goes, and they can't disconnect. You take that person to the truth, they can't even accept it because that preacher is more important than Jesus. And we got people sitting up in church, doomed, following some guy. And because they have this personality in them. And the demons are now yoking that person to him. And they can't break it. Or they won't break it, they can break it. But it feels more comfortable to depend on what I can see than to just walk out there in faith and trust Jesus. Images, housing spirits. Every spirit must have an image. I'm telling you, every spirit must have an image. But you get back to that music. You can take yourself out there on a long head trip for music. I was talking to B the other week about old Temptation song. You remember this one? It said, each day through my window, I watch her as she passes by. I say to myself, I'm such a lucky guy to have a girl like her is truly a dream come true. Out of all the fellows in the world, she belongs to me. Then he says what? But it was just my imagination running away with me. And that's how it works. And guess what happens? All the people walking around just seeing a girl. Look at that. Me and her, we gonna get together. I like her. I can see me driving her in my car and taking her to the movie, to the restaurant. I can see her I had a friend told me that one time, you know. She said, girl, you know what I like to do with her? I said, what? I didn't know what he was gonna say, you know. Tell you what I like to do. You know what I just dream of it. I thought this is my room that night, what I wanna do with this girl. So I want to take her to the movies. Get to the movies and buy some popcorn. And have her eat that popcorn. And I'm going to look at her. And I'm going to flick a piece of popcorn from the corner of her mouth. And she's going to tell me thank you. And the girl was a beautiful girl. You know what I said? Yeah, man, I see what you mean. Yeah, yeah. Man, I almost want to cry. Yeah, that's it, man, that's it. Why? Imagination. But see, back then, kids our age, 16, 17, weren't dirty low down. You know what they be telling them now? You know what I want to do to that girl? I want to take out him in the back, rape her, shoot her in the head, and then get her mama, rape her, and shoot her, and then rob her house. Everybody said, yeah, 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 man, yeah. See, that's what it's mutated into. But it's all imagination feeding the people. You see enough movies, Sylvester Stallone and all these other people, Die Hard 3, just killing and maiming. Your mind is programming that soul and creating images. They shoot a guy 5 times, I'm just Arnold Schwarzenegger. I'm Sylvester Stallone. I'm Dirty Harry. See, that's the image in them, I'm telling you. Why is Michael Jackson such a big star? Because he carries a multitude of demons in his soul. Look at the boy. That ain't a, that's a mutation of a man. You get a bunch of little boys walking on earrings in their ears. And half women, half man. Prince, Michael Jackson. All these sodomite images. And now they're mimicking the image. Women exposed to these masculine looking women, tough women. Now they're walking around with combat boots on. Looking all tough and rugged. While the boys look like little old sissies. Why he painted the minds with the images, the soul programmed, he filled the images with demons, and now you have a replica of the devil himself. The devil's recreating man after his image. What is the thing he's trying to do? He's thumbing his nose at God. What did God say? I made man after my image, after my likeness. The devil says, no, I'm going to recreate him after my image and my likeness. I'm a rebel. I'm an antichrist. I'm going to make man into what I am. And then I'm going to set up a kingdom with Daniel's little horn. And I'm going to rule over man after I've made him to the image of me. No spirit can rule you unless you're the image of that spirit. Lust can't rule you unless you're full of lust. Nothing can rule you unless you're full of that spirit first. And then the spirit comes to join itself to the image of itself. People are yoked to other people after that person becomes so much to them that they've painted that inner man with that their personality. And then the person can dominate that person because they can't break free from it. A lot of us have to cut ties with family members, siblings, people who still have stuff on you. You can pick it up and when they're around you, the drag is on you. The thing has still got you. It's something in your soul that's still shaking because of them being around. They call your name and you can feel it in you. Because there's an image there, there's a spirit there, they control the spirit in the image. And if that image is with you and it's yoked to you, you have a covenant, what the Bible said there in Isaiah 28. You have a covenant and an agreement with hell. If your soul is in agreement with hell, for all intents and purposes, you're full of hell and full of the devil. Now, images all in the soul. People have fantasized so much. And thought about things so much that the images are there and the spirits still interact with the images. They have a woman, hadn't had sex in 30, 40 years. But she's fantasized about it so much until for all intents and purposes, that thing's as alive in her as it is in a hook out there on Stewart Avenue. This thing is deadly. The mind is a dangerous place because your mind can do a lot of things to you and you can sit right here and let it happen. Or you can get the Bible, what the Bible says done to you. Have your mind transformed. It says in Ephesians, be renewed in the spirit of your mind. And you know what? Your mind is spirit. You can't touch your mind. You can't tangibly put your hands on your mind. Your mind is spirit. It has to be transformed by the word of God. Now, why is he transforming your mind? Here's why. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 1. He says, therefore, seeing we have this ministry, as we have received mercy, we faint not, but have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. You know, the conscience is referring to the mind. Our conscious mind, he's commending himself with the truth to a man's conscience. But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. What's the gospel creating? The image of God. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who commanded the light to shine in the darkness, have shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Now here it is. Words preached, sung, read, however you're getting into you, if you'll sanctify yourself from the defiling images, it will begin to create another image in you. The image is Jesus. Now, Jesus is the Word. The Word is Jesus. Remember when Jesus went down to the Jordan River? He was baptized and the Spirit came on Jesus. Jesus is the Word. The Spirit came on the Word. The Word paints Jesus into your soul, and the Spirit then fills Jesus. I told you, every spirit must have an image. The Holy Ghost must have the image of Christ. As long as you have other images there, this is what's happening to us as Christians. We got a spirit that's been redeemed and saved, and a soul that has idols in it. Now the spirit tries to transfer from your spirit and clasp that soul in order to control you and lead you through your life, being led by the spirit, by the spirit being joined to your soul. You've been reunited with God, whole man. Spirit joins to your soul, controls the body. That's called being led by the spirit. But when the spirit sees your soul and begins to come toward it, if it's other images there other than the image of Christ, guess what has to happen? The spirit can't connect with that because it's the wrong image. So then he has to digress and begin to deal with the images first to get them out of there so he can replace that image with Christ, and then he can join to that image because there's no resistance. The spirit and Christ work in unity. If the truth shakes you, rattles you, it's shaky to you, makes you unnerved, scared, or whatever, it's because there are other images in you that are filled with other spirits. You hear about the end time, you start getting scared, you got another image in you. You got the spirit of the world in you because you want the world to still last. Where you see that life don't matter anyway. Because no matter what I'm doing, the world has been destroyed all around me anyway. When those thing and scorpions come down from heaven, when you see the moon turn into blood, you see the sun darken, what are you going to hold on to now? Why wait till then? Why not eradicate the images now so God can use you now? The gifts operate when that spirit has no resistance to the soul. And God only does one thing to us. He shows us what the images are and then shows us how to get rid of them. It's what everybody goes through. People sitting up mad, angry, scared, rejected, nervous. They got images in them the spirit still feels. Holy Ghost can't come on that. Can't do it. As long as those images are there, can't do it. But when those images are dealt with, now the spirit can draw into the soul. The spirit will flow through the soul and use the body as the spirit wills. What happened to the apostles? That's why Peter told Ananias and Sapphira, you haven't lied to me. You lied to the Holy Ghost. He finally was giving himself over to the image of Christ. Jesus told him, after you're converted, now heal your brothers. See, you have a knowledge of me, some words that I've said in you, but you're not converted. The images are still on you that are making you unable to be used. Funny how he ran at the cross. And in Acts, he was there saving 3,000 people with one sermon. What happened? The baptism of the Holy Ghost came on him, flooded through his spirit, joined to his soul, and now he was preaching unconscious of himself. Those images make you conscious of yourself, your surroundings, and how you fit in, and all the rest of this foolishness. Images given by the world. That's idolatry. Filthy idolatry plaguing us, and not allowing God to move from the spirit to the soul and out of the manifestation. God is looking for manifestation. Church folk, religious folk, look for fitting into the group. Fitting in to organizations. Fitting in to what they're saying. Doing what the preacher said, the law. All these filthy images look for anything else other than the image of Christ to form up. Well, Paul said, I'm suffering you with you in birth pains until Christ be formed in you. She's talking about an image. Christ shaped, molded, blossoming in you, and now the spirit can feel that image, and you'll produce life. I'm telling you, this realm in the soul has to be dealt with. And it has to be dealt with now. We don't have time. We don't have time to fool around anymore. We got to deal with it now. People sitting up in church all over this country with a form of godliness denying the power thereof. Because they have a form of Jesus. A lot of them carrying their preacher's personality. Another gospel, another Jesus. What comes into that image? Another spirit. See, I got the wrong Jesus, so you get another spirit. Every image will be filled with the spirit. The spirit of Antichrist, get another image, the Antichrist will fill that image. I'm telling you, I submit to Moon, then I get a spirit from Moon that'll fill the image. Jehovah's Witnesses, fill the image. Mormons, fill the image. Whatever you yield yourself to, the Bible says that same thing will bring you into bondage and captivity. Because that image you create will be filled. That's why it says you're hungry and thirsty after righteousness. Verily, you shall be filled. Truth and Jesus are synonymous. Filled with truth, you fill with Jesus. After you fill with Jesus, the spirit of truth is drawn nigh to Jesus, and he powers up the word. The dirtiest thing down here is this. We have people in churches full of the letter. No spirit. The letter will kill you. See, this is the biggest idol down here, right here. A King James NIV or Amplified Bible. Whatever version you read. Because people take the Bible, you know what they do? They take the words in the Bible and then begin to try to use them to get. That's idolatry. The Bible, the words of the Bible are used to transform you into the image of Christ so Christ can now fill you and he does what he wants to do through you. But when you take this Bible like a magic wand or a talisman and begin to wave it around through confessions and word of faith and all this other stuff to get prosperous, you're a witchcraft worker and another spirit's going to come to fill you. You don't believe that? These people believe this word of faith and prosperity junk. Go and tell them the absolute truth and watch them flinch. Watch them back off of it. Tell them about the end of the world, the Antichrist, the end of time, and the domination of the devil in these last days, and watch them get scared and back off of you fast. You know why? Another Jesus, another gospel, another spirit. If it does not make them feel comfortable in this present world, I don't want to hear it. That's damnable right there. It's going to send a multitude through a lot of hell in their lives, and maybe to hell, because they did not come off of a love for this world, and they used the Bible like a magic wand. These words aren't in here for us to use. They're in here to transform us, to make us over again. Denying everything else and feeding on this Bible. The Bible says we look at this Bible like a mirror until we change into the express image of what's in it. I'm telling you. While we're sitting around giggling and sniggling and cutting the food, the devil's preparing for his fourth march. There's going to be a lot of church folk going to wake up and find out how in the world I get over here in this. Deceived all these years thinking I was in. Because they didn't let those false images go. With the images and those spirits come the desires of those spirits, the feelings of those spirits, the plans of those spirits, the pursuits of those spirits, the minds of those spirits, what they want, what they like, what they want to go, what they're offended by. Like I tell you, you tell us about the absolute unadulterated truth that you get an offensive response, it's another spirit there that they have yielded themselves to. The Bible says in Isaiah chapter 28, you have cut a covenant with hell. And here you are yielding to hell inside and making Christ an enemy. Pharisees and Sadducees did it. Where Abraham see you. What happened? They trusted in Abraham, received the image of spirit filled. God himself comes in the flesh. They crucify him. Because that's not what we want. Abraham's law, the laws that we're walking under, the Abrahamic covenant, and the laws of Moses give us control over the people and give us money, position, and wealth. The same thing is happening in the churches today. Most churches are Satan's seat. It's the devil in the raw controlling the masses. You need the image of Christ formed up in you by you as an individual sanctifying yourself and getting free. Now, I got people always ask me all the time, they say, well, what can we do? Can we do this? Can we do that? I said, you're still weak. You're pitiful. Why don't you give up everything and then let him give back to you what you can do? Run too far and then let him bring you back. Give up everything and then let God return it back to you the way it's supposed to be. You're trying to find the minimum requirement. You'll go to hell trying to find the minimum requirement because what if you miss one? Give up everything. Lose your life. Now find your life.
Let the Holy Ghost tell you what's right or wrong, what you can and cannot do. Stop trying to find out what can I get away with. Can I still look at this? Can I still listen to this kind of music? You're still pitiful. Trying to find out what's the minimum requirement for salvation. My thing is, do the maximum and let God tell you what the minimum is. When I got saved, I started burning records, throwing away clothes, throwing away statues, watches, rings, whatever. Whatever it is I got that's binding me, let me get rid of it now. After I get through with everything now, just tell me how to fell down and be right. But man, if it's a pair of shoes I got to throw away, throw them away. Freedom must ring inside of your spirit and in your soul. Because without that liberty there, you can't see. Because another spirit will fill that place and bind you. I'm telling you, y'all, we're in the last days now. This play stuff is over. I don't care if it's your husband, your wife, your sister, your brother. I don't care who it is. You better cut these folks. I tell y'all time, cut them. Y'all think I'm playing. While you trying to please them, appease their wishes and all the rest of this foolishness, you're going to be drug off into a delusion. Because whatever you join yourself to, you're not outside of that. Well, I go to church here, but I'm not part of it. That's a lie. You're a part of that spirit if you go there. That's the way it is. We just got to fool ourselves all we want with all these old Mickey Mouse excuses. You better make a stand for yourself, and this is where I am, and this is what I'm going to do. If you don't, you're going to find yourself in a bad way in a little while. These images are real. What you expose yourself to, you become it. And that spirit that rules that particular arena will come to reinforce the fact you painted that image. And you let your mind wander off in all these old crazy fantasies, believe me, it ain't just no fantasy. That thing that rules over that fantasy you in is going to come see you. It's real. Father, thank you for this time of sharing. Thank you for the word of God that's able to save our souls. All right, now we commit ourselves to you. Ask you to bless this time of sharing together. Father, create in us the image of your Son. As it says in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, the image of Christ, that the Spirit of Christ might join to us and make us whole. We need the fullness of the Godhead in bodily form, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, to be able to see in these last and evil days. We don't want to fall short of the glory of God. We want the temple full of your glory because we've given credence to only one image, the image of the Son of God, that the Spirit of God might abide in us and work through us. We give the praise and the honor and the glory for one in Jesus' name.